And so you are at home watching television. It's a boring television night. There's not much to see. The remote control is in your hand. It's one infomercial after another, promising you the world. You can drink this one little pill and eat all the pizza and lose all the weight or whatever they are promising you. Boring infomercial. But then you come on to this one infomercial that really tugs your heart. It's about the starving children in Africa. You see the camera zooms in a village, and this little boy is standing there. He can barely breathe, and he is surrounded by flies. He is starving, he is powerless, isolated and condemned. Doesn't look like he's going to make it until the next day. And you kind of felt bad about it. By show of hands, how many of you have seen one of those infomercials in your television before? Yeah. Ma'am, the little boy you saw on your television, powerless, isolated, and condemned, was me. That's my story. Ladies and gentlemen, it is never about the story, it's about the story of the story. You see, most people, because of my story, would give up on life. They would create another story to give up on life. But I did not. And so along the journey that brought me from the little village where I started in Haiti to the man who is standing in front of you today, I have to say there are three fundamental keys that did it for me, that helped me to achieve everything that I have achieved in my life. And those are the three keys that I'm here to share with you. They are very simple. Most people are looking for complicated things to success, and they're complicated. They make it so hard, but it's not that hard. It's very simple. The first key is you must learn to stay with it long enough to make it work. And the second key is to learn to model success. Do not reinvent it. And the third one is to have a B attitude. The B attitude is B-E-E, and I'll tell you what that is in a moment. So let's talk about the first one, the spirit of not quitting. See, most people invest so much time and energy into something, and then they're not seeing the results fast enough. It's not microwave enough for them, and they walk away from something they have invested so much into. They were so close to the gold, so close to get to the promised land that they were looking for, and they walk away. I started in a small village in Haiti. The village was very primitive. There was no running water, no access to medical care. I remember the first time I saw lights in the village was the time I saw the headlights of an old battered truck, Voici fan. I got dizzy. I ran away. My mother left me in the village when I was only 9 months old. Not because mama was a bad mother, but because she had to break the cycle of poverty. She had to go to Port-au-Prince, the city, to find a better way to provide for me. But right after she left, several deadly diseases pounded me. They vowed to end my existence. I remember during the day I would be on the dirt floor, fending flies off my face. And at night I would shoo away the mosquitoes. And I would be hungry, I would be sick, and I would be crawling on the floor in the middle of the dirt floor at night, calling for mama, 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 but she was never there. Until eventually I would curl into a fetus position and I'd fall asleep while crying. There were times that I didn't really want to go outside and even wake up, because so many people in the village, they gave up on me. They called me names to belittle me. They called me Suya and Kokobe. I've told that Suya is a man who was crippled in the village. Kokobe is a Creole word that means crippled. But more importantly, most of the people in the village gave up on me. They predicted that I would not survive to be a man. How do I know that? Because I was a little child at the lady I was staying with, Betila, and a man came to see her, and he told her in front of me that you are wasting your time with him. He is not going to survive. So although most of those people in the village wrote me off, they gave up on me, but here's one thing, they were not my maker. As you look at your life, and some of you, you can go back and remember people who predicted that you would not succeed in this company. And you went against the odds anyway. You never gave up. You stayed in the battle. You faced the rejections and you succeeded anyway. And some of you can remember there are times that people will look at you and they will kind of like give you. And some will tell you directly and some will tell you indirectly. But don't listen to them. They are not your maker. The key to your future is in your hand. It is totally up to you. Now, in the village, life was really tough. And I remember, how many of you remember 1999 at midnight? What was supposed to happen? Y2K, that's right. And then so I was home in Smyrna, Georgia, and then this lady called me, trying to alert me that it's going to be the end of the world. I said, how so? How is it going to be the end of the world, ma'am? She said, well, think about it this way. We will not be able to go to the banks to get our money, to go to gas station to pump gasoline, to drive our car. We will not be able to go to the grocery stores, the cash registers. Everything will come to a screeching halt. It's going to be the end of the world. Can't you see? Even electricity in your house will go out. The gas in everything. She started giving me a whole list of why it's going to be the end of the world. I said, ma'am, wait a minute now. I started having a flashback. I said, really? No electricity? No gas? No bank? No car? I said, ma'am, it's going to be the end of your world, not mine. Because I was born Y2K ready. You see, in life, people will base the failures, okay? They will take all the things that they failed to accomplish, all the failures, and take them all and pile them into a bundle. And when you try to attempt to do something, they will judge you and tell you that it's not possible. You cannot live the Aflac dream because you don't have the ability to present yourself, to speak in public. Wait a minute now. I wasn't born a speaker. I was a very extremely shy guy. I remember the first time I gave a speech for Toastmasters International. It was an icebreaker. How many of you are familiar with Toastmasters International? Yeah, the icebreaker. I mean, I was supposed to talk about myself. But I went on the thing, I was so nervous, my heart was pounding, and I forgot my name. My mind checked out on me. But guess what? I did not give up. I decided that I was going to do it, and I was going to be a speaker. And I kept speaking, I kept speaking, I kept speaking. The best way to get over your fear is to face your fear. Ralph Waldo Emerson said, do the things you fear, and the death of fear is certain. So I don't know how many of you are new associates here. How many of you are less than 2 years with Aflac? Just raise your hands. Well, quite a few of you. I'm here to tell you there are times that you will wake up, you will think about giving up. You will think about quitting. And then don't think you are alone when you think about quitting. When you think about giving up, you are not alone. Because the reality is every single one of us, including the top people you see all the time on television, they woke up sometimes in their life, in their career, and they thought about giving up. The difference really is they did not give up. We all have those thoughts that we want to quit, we want to give up. But I'm telling you, the quitters never win, and the winners never quit. If you stay with it long enough. Now, I left the village eventually. I went to Port-au-Prince to see my mama. It was the first time that I was going to meet my mother and my sister, whom I didn't know, and my brother. They were living in the city with my mama. And when I arrived, I carried a sack of yams and live chickens. And to this day, I still keep that culture. That was our culture in the village. When we go into the city, we always bring a little gift. I brought those things for mama. I arrived in Port-au-Prince. And quite frankly, when I got to Port-au-Prince, I mean, I thought the gods must be crazy because I saw a lot of cars going up and down the street. I saw motorcycles and bicycles. I saw tall buildings. And I'm like, mama must be rich. And when I arrived, I started calling for mama, just like when I was in the village at night. But this time it was a different calling that I was doing because I knew mama was going to hear my voice. And mama knew that I was coming. My sister and my brother, they waited on the curb for me. When they saw me, they ran and they embraced me, braced themselves, and we were all cuddled together. And then mama was in the back preparing something for me. And when she heard me, the woman dropped everything because she hadn't seen her little baby boy since I was 9 months old and I was 7 years old when I arrived in Port-au-Prince. And mama dropped everything and she wiped her hands and she walked toward me and she stretched her arms and she went down and I run and I just jump into my mother's arm. Ladies and gentlemen, that felt so good. Psychologists say children who are not held, touched, and cuddled have a tendency to shrink instead of growing. Prior to that, I was shrinking. But in my mother's arms, I felt like a giant. Sometimes you will find that in your career. Your customers, the people that you are nurturing, that you have there. And sometimes all they need somebody to just listen to them. Sometimes all they need somebody to just stretch their arms and show that there is somebody who is there for them. And it is not just all about business. It's about making a deeper connection with the people you serve. That's what matters. Now, in Port-au-Prince, the conversation was one of discouragement. Give up. How do I know that? They had it in the songs. They talk about it everywhere you go. It's just like everybody, they're telling you that's all there is to life. Again, I'm going to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, you cannot judge your future successes based on your past failures. That doesn't make sense at all right? So I'm in Port-au-Prince, and I'm thinking like, no, there's a better life. And then one day I couldn't eat. Mama didn't have anything to cook for us, and I was so hungry, and there was a lady by the name of Tatida in the neighborhood, and I went to Tatida, and I was talking to her. She was an old lady. But even though she was just as poor as we were, but for some reason, she had a vision. She could see into people. Here's what I want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen. You need to surround yourself with people who can see something in you that you cannot see for yourself. People who will believe in you. People who will cheer you on. That's what Tatida was. Right? And then I went to her and I said, Tatida, it's not fair, in my little kid voice. She said, why? She said, I'll never be anything in my life. I can't eat. Mama can't cook anything. When Christmas comes, there was never any toys for us. And I'm watching the kids across the street playing with the toys. And life is unfair. And that's all there's going to be. And I never forget. She looked at me with a penetrating stare and she told me, don't you ever talk like that. She said, there is something big in you, in spite of your circumstances, in spite of where you are. Ladies and gentlemen, where you are is not who you are. You're much bigger than that. She said, one day you're gonna go places. You're gonna make a name for yourself. You're going to travel all around the world. You'll have plenty of food to eat. Food will never be an issue for you. And every time I hit a stage, I think of Tatida. How many of you here are sales managers here? Just raise your hands. Let me see the sales managers. Quite a few of you. That's your role. That's the nurturing role. Your associates in the field sometimes will come after a rejection. They'll be discouraged. They'll come to talk to you. They want a little bit of encouragement from you. They want to hear some nice words. They want to hear that you can cheer them on. Now, I'm in Chateau Marsh in Port-au-Prince. I'm walking behind the American tourist with an extended hand, begging for, by the way, any of you have been to Haiti before? Any of you? Oh, all right, quite a few of you, right? I'm walking behind the American tourist with an extended hand, begging for whatever they could afford. And one American couple gave me a dime, which was a lot of money, and they touched me compassionately. As a result of that, I said to myself, one day, I want to go to the United States of America to eat lots of rice and chickens. I'm sick of rice and chickens now, quite frankly. You know, I want the steak or lobster or something, right? But that was a dream for me, to come to America to eat lots of rice and chickens. And so I'm going to tell you, when you face rejections, which you will, life is an 80-20 rule, like Vilfredo Pareto, the Italian economist, tell us. You know, ladies and gentlemen, 80% of the income in this room is owned by 20% of the people in this room. 80% of income in Aflac total is by 20% of the people in Aflac. This is incredible, but this is good math. This is what it is. The question is, and 80% of your leads will amount to nothing. But how do you know? You don't know which one is the 80%. Go ask the farmer. When the farmer takes the seeds, plants the seeds, it doesn't know, right, that it's only 20% of the seeds that are going to yield the crop. The farmer nurtures all the seeds. That's what we do. But I'm telling you that because when you go in the field and you face rejections and disappointments so that you do not give up and you understand that's part of the 80%. You've got to go through the 80% to get to the 20%. It's a numbers game. That's what it is. And so how do you really unlock the key to dream the Aflac dream? How do you do so? How you do it is you've got to have a vision. You've got to have some goals. You can't just wing it. You've got to create a vision for yourself. When the American couple touched me, I created a vision for myself instantly that I want to go to the United States of America. Now, I began to collect little American flags. You got to surround yourself with what I call triggers, to trigger you, to remind you of the vision, to remind you if there's a number that you want to make in Aflac, because, you know, you cannot fail in Aflac. It's impossible to fail. If you fail, it's your fault, really. I hate to say that. But, you know, they created it in a way for you that you can't fail. And so I had the vision, all right? And so I put all the little flags, and eventually I left Haiti. Okay, I flew, I was playing theater, drama with a theater company, and I went to Montreal, Canada. And from Montreal, Canada, I came to the United States of America. Now, I'm not going to tell you how I came, because I don't know how many of you are working for Donald Trump. So I'm not going to tell you, but I'm a proud citizen of this great country, and I love this country. Now, I'm in the United States, all right? I did not speak any English. And I'm looking at the country, and I had to succeed in the country because I knew. How do I know that I had to succeed in the country? Because I saw people succeeding. How do I know every single one of you can succeed in Aflac? The proof is in the pudding. There are so many millionaires and so many people succeeding. And if they can do it, so can you. They have absolutely nothing over anybody, nothing special, except that they have the will to go through the rejections and they have the desire to never quit. Now, I became a motivational speaker in America, and I had a job at a hotel. I was a doorman, all right? And I was carrying bags. I was at the hotel, okay? And I'm parking cars, and I discovered books in the back seat of the cars that I was parking. And I was reading, and one of the books talk about being a motivational speaker. I say, heck, I tried everything in America. I was a dishwasher, a boot carpenter, everything. If there's some speaking and they pay for you too, I say, oh, I'll try that. Now, how many of you know, as soon as you set a goal, as soon as you have a vision for yourself, there are going to be some little voices in your head that are going to talk you out of it. And the reason that voice is going to talk you out of it is because you have tried something in the past that didn't work. And based on that, it's telling you, oh, no, you can't. The little voice said, man, you're going to try to be a motivational speaker in America? I'm like, yeah. Here's what I knew for certain. Remember I told you if somebody is doing it, that is proof enough that you can do it too? I said to myself, wait a minute now. I wake up every day. I watch television. There's a guy in America, every morning he wakes up and he's motivating Americans. He's giving advice to Americans. I say, look, if Jerry Springer can do this, I can do this too, right? I mean, what can stop me? And as soon as I said I'm going to be a motivational speaker, and things begin to happen for me. Now, you declare a thing because your tongue has the power of life and death. And once you declare it, you believe it, it shall happen. That's all there is to it. There's no secret. I said to myself, okay, I'm going to be a motivational speaker. They would shake my hand, and many of them in my monkey suit would not really take me too seriously, but some would, like Jeffrey Gittermore, who became, how many of you have heard of Jeffrey Gittermore before, who became my personal mentor and wrote the foreword for my book, because I met him at the door. I told him that. But guess what happened? I saved every penny that I had to go to the National Speakers Association, to the convention. I didn't have any money to buy food or anything. I stayed in a little motel so far away. But you know what? I dressed up, I showed up. And when Jeffrey Gittermore saw me, he saw that I wanted that so bad. And Jeffrey Gittermore gave me his card, and Dan Burris, the futurist, and a bunch of them gave me their business cards, and they wanted to help me. Why? Because I showed up. Who was that? Woody Allen, who said success is 99% showing up. That's what it is. I showed up. I'm at the convention, and I went to the same people I saw at the hotel. I was like, hi, sir. This is Rene Godefroy, your doorman, sir. Remember me? I was the doorman in Atlanta carrying your bags. I told you I was going to do this. Here I am, sir. I'm here. And I really have the fire in me. I want to do this. Now, speaking of fire, ladies and gentlemen, I'm at the door, and there's a gentleman. Aflac used to have the conference at the hotel every year. Some of you might remember me when I was a doorman, and if you are in here and you didn't tip me, I'm here. You can give me my tip now. You know what I'm saying? And so I'm at the hotel. This gentleman by the name of Lance Osborne, he is at the conference and coming out of the conference, but he was observing me and watching me. He saw how excellent I was, and he thought to himself, this guy probably be a good associate for Aflac or something. And he came to me and said, what do you want to do for the rest of your life? What's your vision? What do you want to do? I said, oh, sir, I'm so glad you asked, because I'm about to tell you. I said, sir, I'm going to go be one of the top motivational speakers in America. I said, sir, I'm going to write a book, and my book is going to be a bestseller. I know it, sir. Sir, this is it. This is what I want to do. Nothing else that I want to do. I want to focus on this. Here's a lesson for you. Some of you are just looking for opportunities everywhere. You've got it in your hand, Aflac is. But you're just so caught up in other things, you can't focus and commit and give it 100% to make this thing work, right? And you know what, Len's husband, soon as he heard that, he saw the fire, he saw the size of my commitment. He gave me his business card. He said, look, here's my business card. I don't know what I can do for you, but I can see that you are going to do this thing. But keep it, you never know. I said, thank you very much, sir. I took the business card. I went home next to my desk. I put it there, and I began to visualize. I began to say, one day, I'm going to be a speaker for Aflac. Ladies and gentlemen, when you create that vision to live the Aflac dream, put the number somewhere where you can see it, and then keep telling yourself, because you have to trick your subconscious mind so that when you wake up, you can have the motivation, the desire, the power, the energy to do this thing, right? And so, you know how long I kept that card? For well over 10 years. I had left the hotel, had enough rice and chickens, you know. I was speaking and my speaking business was doing okay. And then one day I was sitting there and the phone rang out of the blue. And I looked at the caller ID, it says Aflac. I'm thinking to myself, I've never done anything for Aflac. Who would be calling me from Aflac? I picked up the phone, the voice said, this is Lance Osborne. I said, Mr. Osborne? Wow! I said, sir, I waited for your call for over 10 years now. I said, wait a minute now, let me prove it to you. I pulled his business card, I read everything on the business card to him. He said, well, the only thing, everything on the business card is wrong except for my name. Because years ago when I met you, I was just in the fields. And now he's a vice president and all of this on his business card, he was telling me. And he said, so, we have a big meeting in Atlanta. It is called Focus. And we have a speaker every year. We have a senator. But this year, Nancy Pelosi has something where they want every senator to stay in Washington, D.C., and I'm just listening to the story because I already know that senator is going to stay in Washington, D.C. Because what is mine is mine. All right? What is yours is yours. When you put the number on the screen, it is your number. All right? Am I right? Look at somebody to your right and left and say, this is your number. Yeah. That's what it is. And so he said, we're going to book you if the senator cannot make it to town. I said, don't worry about it. I'm all right. And I started praying. I'm saying, no, senator is coming here. I know I was praying. But, you know, some people say, you didn't have a voodoo doll, you from Haiti? I said, no. I was praying. And eventually, they booked me to speak for Aflac. But here's one part of the story that you didn't hear. When I get off at the hotel every night at 11 o'clock, whenever there is a conference, okay, and Aflac included, what I would do, every one of my coworkers would be going in one direction to go home. I would go to that ballroom at night, and I'd stand there and I'd visualize the crowd is my crowd. I am the speaker. I would give my speech to that audience. Ladies and gentlemen, there's power in vision and imagination. When they booked me to speak at Focus, I said, you know what? This is going to be exciting. This is the story that I'm going to tell. How many of you were at that meeting, Focus? I know Matthew. Where's Matthew Butler? Matthew Butler was the first speaker who actually booked me. I mean, I'm so grateful to you, sir. I mean, right after this speech, you booked me to speak at your state. You were in Iowa? That's right. And so I went to the stage, and I got on the stage, and I stood on the edge of the stage. I looked at the crowd. I said, all of you here are seeing me for the first time. For me, I've seen you so many times. I've been on that stage for so many times. This is a return visit, and it's good to see you back again, because I was visualizing you on a stage. And I was sharing that there was a woman in the front of the room who was in tears, and she just was like this, my mother. Mama was just so proud of me. It was the first time she saw me speaking, and I recognized my mother. And she stood up. They gave her a standing ovation. I was in California not long ago speaking. There was a long line of people in line to buy books. They couldn't get to me long enough. They went to my mother to get autograph. Many people, including my mother, didn't really like that I was going to tell strangers all my business. And I remember Mama said to me, why do you have to go and tell a bunch of strangers about our business? What do you have to tell them? That we slept on the floor with rats and roaches, and the rats used to nibble the bottom of your feet. That's too much, son. Can you just tell them you're from Haiti? I said, Mama, no, that's okay. I'm actually making a living in America. That's good. It's good, Mama. Mama said, I don't know about that. And one day I spoke for AT&T, and I got home 2 weeks later, the check came in the mail. And when I took the check and I opened it, I called Mama. I said, Mama, come see this. I said, come on. And Mama stood next to me and I opened it. And when Mama saw the number on the check, Mama said, son, why don't you tell more stories? She was thinking the more stories I told, the bigger the check would be. Ladies and gentlemen, when I share a story, everybody gets something different out of the story. But the reason I share my story with you is because I wanted to distract you from your story that is not serving you so that you can create a better story for yourself. Does that make sense? I'm in Miami. I don't speak any English, which is the second point I want to cover with you, model success. And some of you are not succeeding as fast as you can succeed in this company because you are too smart for the system that they created that works. You try to deviate. You try to reinvent success. It doesn't work that way. It is what it is. And all the mistakes that were supposed to be made, they started happening in 1955 in Columbus, Georgia. All the veterans who are there with the company, how many of you have been with the company for 20 years or more? Raise your hands. You see, you look at them, all those veterans, they already paid the price. They made all the mistakes. They really worked the system for you. So don't be too smart for the system. Model success. I am in Miami. I don't speak any English. I don't know anybody, but I have to make it in America. In fact, the first two words I learned in English were same thing. Same thing. Two words. I use them to the max. To this day, I'm still using those two words. So what do? I'm hungry. I go to a McDonald's. And I couldn't read the menu. Back then, they didn't really have pictures. Some 33, 32 years ago, I'm standing there. And I'm looking at the menu. I couldn't order anything because I didn't speak English. But I know two words, same thing. So I realized people were ordering. One lady was ordering. And I went behind the lady and I stood there. And I waited for her to order. And then, so I'm standing there. She ordered. She moved away. The lady said, can I take your order, sir? Guess what I said? Same thing didn't always taste the same. I don't want to reinvent success. Why do I want to do that? Right? I go to a dinner, and then I'm sitting there with all these people eating, and they have some different knives and things. I'm with all the big executives ready to eat. They said, I'm sitting next to this gentleman. And then, because I don't know what to hold first and next and something, I'm just confused. I don't know, right? I mean, you know, I'm from a small village. I started with my hand. You know what I'm saying? Now you give me 20,000 knives and this and come on. I mean, just give me some rice and chickens. I'm cool. You know what I'm saying? The guy sitting next to me, one of the VPs, he said, Mr. Godefroy, you are our guest. Why don't you start first? I said, oh, no, sir, you know, I like to take my time when I'm eating. Why don't you start first? What am I doing there? I'm waiting for him. Whatever he grabs, that's what I'm going to grab. He grabs this. I'm like, there you go. He grabs that. There you go. Now, I have to tell you, I was telling once that story for so many times, and one lady pulled me aside, and she said, I'm going to tell you how it works. You start outside, and you, am I right? That's a millennium right there. She said, yeah. You start outside, and then you go in. I said, okay, then I got it. Do I want to reinvent success? I don't know. When I left Haiti, I didn't own a suit. I don't know what it is to dress. You know how I learned to dress? First, I started watching the people at the door, how they dress. You know, today, Alan had his designer, the fashion guy, came to deliver the suit. I'm like, are you kidding me? Yeah, I mean, for real, I was there. He introduced me. I was like, really? I mean, people have it like that in Aflac? Is that a custom made, Alan? Oh, Lord. I'm telling you, go to the Aflac system and apply it over and over as it should be. It's guaranteed you will succeed. I'm speaking somewhere, and this lady came. She said, I want to have a conversation with you. I said, okay, you can talk to me. She said, my husband gets on my last nerve. I said, why? He can never fold his handkerchief as nice as you fold yours. He always takes it like a bunch of nothing and pull it in, and he gets on my last nerve. I said, is that right, ma'am? Is that a problem in your marriage? She said, yeah, it's a big problem. I said, I'm gonna fix your marriage today for you. Where's your husband? She said, he's in the back. I said, go get him. And then she went and got the husband. The husband came, and I looked at him. He's like, yeah, I know what she told you. I said, yeah, but I'm gonna help you. I'm gonna fix your marriage for you. I mean, is there a couch here or anything? I said, so you mean your handkerchief is the problem and she would like it as nice as mine? He said, yeah. I said, I'm gonna show you right now in less than 5 seconds how to solve that problem. I said, sir, it's, look, it's cardboard. I believe you ought to fake it until you make it. I said, you go get him, Jesse Penny. I said, you can get it in blue, purple, orange, whatever color you want. Give me a break. Trying to tell me you got a problem in your marriage. Oh, no, I see the guy how to do it. I just didn't look good on me. Then, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Ladies and gentlemen, the message that I'm giving to you is, first, do not give up. Plant the seeds. Go get the leads. Nurture them over and over. Don't worry about not seeing them coming up. They will come up, because it takes some time. Because people buy from people that lack and trust. Okay? So it takes time for them to lack and trust you. And some of you come with in this company and you look at Brent and you say, oh, Brent got his going on, right? I mean, he started the company when they had a lot of opportunities, you know. The company was young and he grew up with the company and he makes all his money. But he does all of that. But I can't do that. But here's what I want to say to you. Brent started somewhere. I mean, you're starting somewhere. What's the difference? You just pay your dues. The fact that Brent made it in the company is confirmation for me that if I'm willing to do it, all right, I can do it too. And ladies and gentlemen, ask for help. Swallow your pride. And I'm saying this for the old veterans here in the company and the millennium here. Are you the only millennium, man? No. There's a bunch of them here. And you all know about social media like no other, right? I mean, y'all older gentlemen here, just talk to them. You're never too old to teach. You're never too old to learn. You can talk to them because you have so much to offer them. They can model your success. But we know the game has changed in marketing. It's the new way of marketing. It's not the same thing. So learn from them. How many of you understand what is the Aflac dream? And okay, first of all, let me ask you. By show of hands, how many of you want to live the Aflac dreams? Raise your hands. All right, great. That is superb. And guess what? I'm here to tell you. It is your dream. Because you are, especially the new associates, I'm going to say this to you. You are more powerful than you think you are. You are more capable than you think you are. And I'm telling you because I know the potential that you have. I know that you can live the Aflac dream, that it is possible for you. There is something extraordinary inside of you waiting to be unleashed. And how do you do so? Vision. You set some goals and you have a vision and you surround yourself with people, the right people, and you surround yourself with the right triggers to trigger your mind. Which brings me to this. Have a B attitude, B-E-E. Okay, how many of you know when a bee is out, what is the bee looking for? Pollen. And the bee creates what? Honey. Okay, when I was a little boy in the village, there's a man by the name of Raphael. I remember he told me this. I saw a bunch of bees going around. And I asked him, what are the bees doing? He said, all the bees, they are busy looking for honey. And he told me, but the rattlesnakes in the village, son, they are looking for bitterness. They suck on the bitterness to create the poison so that they can kill and destroy. He said, a lot of the people in our society, they are just like the rattlesnakes. And some are just like the bees. You know, the bee is a person that will look at you and see something you don't see in yourself. And they'll bring that thing and make you see it. They cheer you up. They encourage you. They tell you to press on, not to give up. They tell you to learn to model success. They are always there. They want to coach. They want to teach you. They want to be there with you. That's the bee. How many of you can remember a person when you came to Aflac who actually was there for you? Quite a few of you. That's what Aflac is. Aflac is a family. He told me the rattlesnakes, on the other hand, they are different. They are always looking for something that is bitter. They come with this within this family here. And one rattlesnake, one negative person, ladies and gentlemen, can really set the team back. Am I right? All right? You got those people, they are always looking for a reason to quit. They are always looking for why it's not working out, why it's not possible. No matter what you put in front of them, no matter how you try to paint the picture of the future for them, but they keep coming back to their comfort zone where all the rattlesnakes are to tell you it's not going to work. That's the rattlesnakes, right? And they're there to discourage you. They're there to talk you down and put you down and stuff like. How many of you know a rattlesnake by show of hands? How many of you are living with one? Quite a few. I mean, you know, sometimes you can really live with a rattlesnake for real. And I was talking and I asked the audience, what do you do with a rattlesnake? And one lady said, you just cut its head off. Is that what you do with a rattlesnake for real? You cut its head off? Yeah, except that Mahatma Gandhi said, in a world where it is an eye for an eye, everybody is blind. You do not cut the rattlesnake's heads off. What do? You pour enough honey on the rattlesnake, because rattlesnakes cannot afford to be a rattlesnake as long as you are pouring honey on them. It's just like the whole thing is, you try to not return the meanness of the person. You try to put love. You try to really go out of your way, because eventually they'll turn around. Now, rattlesnakes, they love darkness. They just talk negative. Everything is negative. Now, when I said I was going to become a motivational speaker, there was a guy at the hotel who was my supervisor, and he basically told me that, man, you're going to be a motivational speaker? I said, yeah, I'm going to be a motivational speaker. He said, with your English the way it is? He said, come on. He said, you don't even speak English. You think America is going to pay you to tell your story about where you're from, Haiti, and all that? Ladies and gentlemen, when you share your dream and vision, you go home, you share the Aflac dream. You say, hey, I just found out that over 5,000 agents in the field, associates, are making $173,000 a year in commissions, in bonuses, and stocks. And I'm going to live the Aflac dream. I'm going to make that much money just like they are making it too. And you go share it with somebody. What are you looking for? You're looking for a little bit of encouragement. I'm like, bro, if you cannot encourage me, you need to get out of my face, man. I don't want to see you. I'm not looking for your approval. You don't hold. There are going to be many critics in your life, ladies and gentlemen, but you must know that the critics don't hold the key to your future, and they don't pay your bills. And I said, as a matter of fact, man, I'm going to write a book. He said, a book? Do you have any credentials? You say you're gonna write a book? I said, oh yeah, I'm gonna write a book. He said, you know you have to have a certain PhD and something to write a book? I said, what you don't know is I have a PhD, man. My PhD, P stands for persistence. Don't quit, stay with it. H is for hope, and D is for dream. Watch out, one day I may autograph a copy of my book to you. You're trying to discourage me. Guess what, I wrote my book. That's right, I wrote my book. Listen, thank you very much. Look, I didn't know how to write a book, but I know two words. I just go to the bookstore. I looked at the books. I said, is that how they are? I said, they have a little red star. I said, put me one here too. Make it look good. You see what I'm saying? I said, I write the book. I called Jeffrey Gilmore. I said, I'm writing a book, man. If you don't ask, you don't receive. You know, so many people, they go to so many different meetings with the prospects and they never ask for the sell. If you don't ask, you don't receive. He said, yeah, I'll write the forward for your book. And I was going to speak at the hotel one day at the Waverly Renaissance in Atlanta. And I got out of my car. I'm going to Keynote conference. The doorman is coming to Keynote conference. I'm walking at the hotel and I'm going to speak. And I walk at the hotel like this. Guess who I was looking for? That supervisor, that guy. I saw him from a distance. I said, hey, buddy. He said, hey, how you doing? I said, nya, 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 nya. The biggest revenge, ladies and gentlemen, in life is success. That's the biggest revenge. Go out there in the field and do what you're supposed to do. Take the system, go in it, learn it and apply it and succeed. And go back to the people who are suggesting you do something else now and say, nya, 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 nya. I can do it. So I read the book. By the way, I'd like to give this copy away. Anybody would like to have this copy? Now, I will autograph it for you if you want it. Anybody here wants a cup? Okay. Give him a big hand. What's your name, sir?
Jim Hill.
Jim Hill. Give me a handshake.
Pleasure meeting you, sir.
Awesome. Pleasure meeting you. How long have you been with Aflac?
2 years.
2 years. That's a winner right there. You know what? Give him a big hand. I'm gonna autograph it for you. It's $50 for the autograph. Later, after.
I gotta get it for my wife.
Okay. Yeah, when I was a kid in my village, our Christmas toys used to come with the seaweeds. And I would go by the edge of the ocean, but there were so many kids waiting for those plastic toys with the seaweeds. And the only way we will get the best is to swim and go get it. Most people in life say, oh, I want to live the American dream, the Aflac dream. I want to do this. I want to make $173,000 just like they're talking about these other guys. But it's all a bunch of I want to. There is no go get it. If you want it, go. That's why I said, man, you're a winner, right? You just go. By the way, if you've been with this company for less than 2 years, please stand up. Let me see you. Give him a big round. Great. And to me, hold on. So remain standing. I want to come down here. You can. So I want to make sure that I see your face. Because I'm going to come back eventually in the future. I want to make sure that I see the superstars because I know 20% of you are going to really make it. It's the 20-80 rule. I don't know which one of those 20s. But if that's you, come up front. I want to take a picture with you because I want to make sure that in the future that I have a record that you say you're going to do it. If that's you that's going to really make it big enough, like come up front and I want somebody to take a picture for us really quick. Really do that. I want somebody to take a picture for us. Come up front. Give him a big hand. That's awesome. That's awesome. Oh, wow. Awesome. Oh, this is amazing. This is great. I mean, take some picture, Alan. Take some pictures. Anybody can take some pictures for us?
Said,
come on.
I'm only 4 hours in.
Oh, 4 hours?
He passed his test today.
Oh, my God. 4 hours in.
Andy.
4 hours.
We're standing by you.
Oh, I'm standing by you too, darling.
Hey, everybody in there.
All right. Awesome. We're going to show the world what we can do in Aflac. Am I right?
Yeah.
Awesome. Great. Give him a big hand. Thank you very much. Wow, 4 hours?
Yes.
Okay. Hi. How are you? Here. I've got something for you. Who is it? This guy has been 4 hours. And who is the newest again? I want to see who else is the newest again. How many? 4 hours. Who comes after him? 3 months? 2 months. Okay. 3 months. Okay. Well, okay. How many? A month and a half. So.
Yes.
1, 2, 3, 4.
I'm still like signing my contract.
You're signing your contract?
Yeah.
Oh, that is awesome. What's your name?
Edward Hamilton.
Edwards, okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, I got a book for each one of you. 4 books, okay? Just see me. I'll sign it. That is so amazing. Now, I'm going to come, and I'm going to have this picture, okay? And I want you to get a copy of this picture. I want you to put it next to your desk, just like I put the business card for Lenz Osborne. To remind you that you declared that you are going to be a top winner in Aflac. Am I right? Awesome. Let me close, ladies and gentlemen. To remind you, I came to the United States with $5, 2 shirts, 1 pair of pants, and I did not speak any English. What would you do? What would you do? You say same thing? I like that. That's right. That's what you would do. Ladies and gentlemen, those 3 things I shared with you, I promise you, if you internalize them, the spirit that no matter how many rejections you get, you say that you will not quit. You will stay with it. And then you learn to model success. So I came to the United States of America. I didn't have a family. I didn't have any resources. I didn't have any connection. I didn't speak the language. So when you go out in the field and you are struggling and you get some rejections, I want you to remember, if this guy can come to this country with nothing, absolutely nothing, no family, all right? I don't know where you are as you are starting in this company, the new associates. Some of you, maybe you just filed for bankruptcy. Some of you, maybe you lost your home. Some of you are trying to bounce back. You're starting just like I came with a little suitcase and $5. You don't speak the language of Aflac yet. That's okay. Because you know what? At least you're starting in a family. You have a family. You have the training. You have Alan and the whole team there to support you, to help you, to guide you, to nurture you, to encourage you. You have them there for you. Ladies and gentlemen, it is true that better together is the key, is all the team and all the associates, all the family that you have behind you, all the resources. So I'm looking forward to coming back and to see all the winners. And God bless you. May you make 2016 the best year ever. Thank you. 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 I appreciate it.